3.
Well, hello everybody, welcome back. We continue our study on the secrets of Pentecost. And this is lecture number 4 in the series, and the title today is Matthias, Wrong or Right Choice. Before we get into our study, however, we want to do what we do every time, and that is to bow our heads reverently to ask for the Lord's presence as we open His Word. So let's bow and pray to the Lord. Father in heaven, we come before your throne this evening, thanking you for your many blessings that you pour out upon us each day. We thank you for life and health and strength and for your holy word, which is a sure guide in a world that is so confused. And we ask that as we study this topic tonight, that your Holy Spirit will be with us, that you will enlighten us, that you will help us to understand how much Jesus loves us and how much he wants us to be with him. And we thank you, Father, for the privilege of approaching your throne in prayer. And we know that you have inclined your ear to hear us because we ask it in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. As we begin our study today, I would like to review the chronology of the last days of Christ upon this earth. And when I say the last days, we're going to begin with the beginning of his earthly ministry. You know, he lived many years before he began his earthly ministry, which lasted about 3.5 years. So we're going to begin where Jesus began his public ministry. 3.5 years that Jesus lived on this earth before he actually went through his events in Gethsemane and on the cross. Now, why did Jesus come to live in our midst for 3.5 years before he went to the cross? The reason is very simple. The sanctuary actually begins in the camp where those who need the sanctuary live. And Jesus came to live in our midst because he had to live a perfect life to offer the law the perfection that the law requires. None of us can offer the law perfection. And so because we can't offer the law perfection, we needed Jesus to come to this earth and to live the life that the law requires from us. So the work of Jesus during 3.5 years, he faced all of the devil's temptations. He never gave in to temptation even once in thought or in action, and he developed perfection in our place. But it wasn't sufficient for Jesus to live the life that we should live. It was also necessary that somebody die carrying our sins, because the wages of sin is death. And so after living his perfect life, at the end of his life, the Lord Jesus went into the court of the sanctuary, the altar of sacrifice, and he died for our sins. All of the sins of the world were placed upon him, and he died in place of all. So in the camp he lives for all, at the altar he dies for all, and then the next piece of furniture that we have in the sanctuary is the laver. And the laver represents the resurrection of Christ. In other words, the camp is his life, the altar of sacrifice is his death, the laver would represent his resurrection. And of course, he ministered for 3.5 years. At the end of the 3.5 years, on a Friday, he died on the cross, was buried, remained in the tomb on the Sabbath, according to the commandment, and then early on the first day of the week, Jesus resurrected from the dead. And then after Jesus resurrected from the dead, he spent 40 days on this earth before he ascended to heaven. And why would Jesus stay upon this earth for 40 days after his resurrection? Why didn't he go and stay in heaven once for all when he resurrected? The reason is explained in Acts chapter 1 and verse 3. Acts chapter 1 and verse 3 gives two reasons why Jesus remained on this earth for 40 days before his final ascension to heaven. It says there in Acts 1 verse 3, to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days. So the first reason is to appear to many to give them proof that he had resurrected. And then the second reason is at the end of the verse, it says, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. In other words, Jesus had some instructions that he still needed to give his disciples. And those instructions involved, first of all, explaining the prophecies about his death and resurrection that the disciples had misunderstood, and then also he explained to them prophecies that were going to be fulfilled in him on the day of Pentecost. So during those 40 days, basically Jesus taught them the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. He taught them the meaning of the prophecies that had been fulfilled in him and the prophecies that would be fulfilled in him on the day of Pentecost. And then after the 40 days, the Lord Jesus gathered with his disciples on the Mount of Olives east of Jerusalem to ascend to heaven. And we find that record in Acts chapter 1 and verses 9 through 11. Acts chapter 1 verses 9 through 11, and I want to read that passage. It says, "Now when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men, which are angels, stood by them in white apparel, who also said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, who was taken up from you into heaven, will so come in like manner as you saw him go to heaven." And then Jesus disappeared from their sight. Now the question is, why did Jesus go to heaven? Why didn't he just end sin after he died on the cross and he resurrected? Why was it necessary for Jesus to go to heaven upon his ascension? Jesus himself gave us the reason. In John 14 verses 1 through 3, a passage that is very well known by all of us, Jesus was in the upper room with his disciples, and I know that you can repeat this from memory. This is the marvelous promise about the second coming of Christ, and I'm going to read it because it explains why Jesus went to heaven at the end of the 40 days and why he's still there. What is Jesus doing in heaven? It says there in John 14, 1-3, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions." Now, you know, there's this idea that Jesus went to heaven to build mansions for us. Well, I have no doubts that, you know, Jesus is building some real nice mansions for us. But the fact is that this text doesn't say that he was going to build mansions in the future. He says, "In my Father's house are many mansions." In other words, when Jesus spoke these words, the mansions were already there. Are you understanding my point? Now notice what he continues saying. "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." Now usually we've understood this to mean that Jesus is going to prepare a beautiful home for us in heaven, you know, and he's going to plant trees and he's just going to make everything beautiful for us. And I'm not denying that that might have something to do with it, but Jesus doesn't need 2,000 years to plant trees and to make a place beautiful. After all, he made a beautiful world in 6 days. There's something more here than just preparing a beautiful place. It says here, "I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Now if we read the book of Hebrews and also the book of Revelation, as well as certain portions of the book of Acts, particularly Acts chapter 1 and chapter 2, we'll see that Jesus went to heaven to prepare a place for us by the work that he performs in the heavenly sanctuary. In other words, Jesus, after his death and his resurrection in the court, still had to fulfill the function in the holy place, and later on he had to fulfill the work of the most holy place. So Jesus prepares the place in heaven for us by the work that he does in the holy place and in the most holy place of the sanctuary. Unless he performs those two works, Jesus can't come again. It's part and parcel of the plan of salvation. And so Jesus ascended to heaven to prepare a place for us by the work that he performs in the holy place and in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. Now after Jesus ascended to heaven, the disciples returned from the Mount of Olives to the upper room, and they prepared for the reception of the Holy Spirit, because Jesus had promised that the Holy Spirit would be poured out 10 days after his ascension. And we notice that in the upper room, the preparation involved a deep prayer experience It involved studying the prophecies such as they had never studied them before. It involved ironing out all of their differences and being emptied of self, placing all of their possessions on the altar of sacrifice so that they could be used in the preaching of the gospel. And in this way they prepared themselves for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which was going to take place 10 days after the ascension of Christ. So we know what the disciples did during those 10 days. They prayed like never before, they studied the prophecies, they were emptied of self, they ironed out the differences that they had had among themselves, they took their possessions and they presented them on the altar of sacrifice for the preaching of the gospel. In other words, they were not centered in themselves, now they were centered in Christ. But the big question is this: what happened with Jesus during those 10 days? We know that he ascended at the beginning of those 10 days after the 40 days on earth, but what was happening to Jesus in heaven during those 10 days? That is the primary question that we want to answer in our study today. What was happening with Jesus during the 10 days between the ascension and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost? Now let's begin our study specifically by seeing who was present there in the upper room. Acts chapter 1 and verse 13 explains by name those who were present there. It says, "And when they had entered, they went up into the upper room where they were staying." And then here you have the names: Peter 1, James 2, John 3, and Andrew 4, and Philip 5, and Thomas 6, and Bartholomew 7, and Matthew 8, and James the son of Alphaeus 9, and Simon the Zealot 10, and Judas the son of James 11. Now what strikes you about this list? Well, it's actually quite simple. You only have 11 apostles, and we know that Jesus established 12. So immediately the question among those who are in the upper room, not so much the apostles but others who were present, is what happened to apostle number 12? What happened with him? If there were 12, why are there only 11? And so Peter now feels like he has to stand up and he has to explain why there are only 11 apostles. And in Acts chapter 1 and verses 18 and 19, Peter explains what happened to apostle number 12. And he expresses it this way: "Now this man purchased a field with the wages of iniquity," speaking of Judas, "and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle, and all his entrails gushed out. And it became known to all those dwelling in Jerusalem, so that field is called in their own language Akeldama, that is, field of blood." So basically Peter is saying, you know, Judas fell a long distance, and when he hit the ground, you know, his belly exploded and his entrails came out. Now when we examine the story in Acts about the end of Judas, and we look at the story in the Gospels, there is an apparent contradiction. I say apparent because there is no contradiction. In the Gospels it says that Judas went and he hung himself. And here in Acts it says that he fell a long distance and his belly exploded and his entrails came out. So how do you reconcile these two stories, the story in the Gospels and the story in the book of Acts? The answer is provided in a beautiful way by Ellen White. In the book Desire of Ages, page 722, she explains and she actually relates these two stories so that they don't contradict themselves, but they actually complement one another. I want to read that statement, Desire of Ages 722. It's speaking about the procession to the cross. "Later that same day, on the road from Pilate's hall to Calvary, there came an interruption to the shouts and jeers of the wicked throng who were leading Jesus to the place of crucifixion. As they passed a retired spot, they saw at the foot of a lifeless tree the body of Judas. It was a most revolting sight. His weight had broken the cord by which he had hanged himself to the tree. In falling, his body had been horribly mangled, and dogs were now devouring it." So what a beautiful way of reconciling these two stories. Judas did hang himself, but the rope with which he hung himself broke, and because it was a very high branch, he fell a long distance and his belly exploded and his entrails came out. There's no contradiction. The two stories complement one another. And so Peter now says to those who are gathered together, we need to name a successor for Judas. Now, for many, many years I wondered why it was so urgent and important for them to elect a successor for Judas before the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, because this is happening in Acts chapter 1, and the Holy Spirit is not poured out until Acts chapter 2. So I wondered, why was it so important for them to dedicate a period of time to electing a successor for Judas before the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost? Why would this be the first item of business? Well, the fact is that Peter explained that the reason why they needed to name a successor is because prophecy required it. You see, Jesus had explained prophecy to Peter and to the apostles. Peter now knew which prophecies to quote to prove that what they were going to do was in harmony with the prophecies of the Old Testament. Notice Acts chapter 1 and verse 16, and then we'll jump to verse 20 because we already noticed what comes in between. The Apostle Peter mentioned two prophecies from the Old Testament that were fulfilled in Judas. Notice what it says in verse 16. Here Peter is speaking to those who are gathered in the upper room. There's about 120. Men and brethren, this scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke before by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. And then we go to verse 20, because we already studied about the end of Judas in verses 17 through 19. Verse 20, for it is written in the book of Psalms. So now Peter is going to give proof from scripture that what they're about to do is in harmony with what God has announced. So, for it is written in the book of Psalms, let his dwelling place be desolate, and let no one live in it. He's quoting Psalm 69 and verse 25. In other words, Judas was not going to return to his home. His home was going to remain desolate. So the first prophecy is found in Psalm 69, 25. Let his dwelling place be desolate, and let no one live in it. And then the Apostle Peter quotes Psalm 109 verses 7 and 8 by saying, and let another take his office. So in other words, somebody else had to take the office of Judas. There had to be apostle number 12. And so Peter is saying, prophecy mandates that we elect a successor in place of Judas. Now, there's this myth that has been passed along from generation to generation in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and that is that it was God's plan that the successor of Judas not be Matthias, who was actually elected, but that it was God's plan that the successor be Saul of Tarsus, who later became the great apostle Paul. And so they say, you know, what happened is that the apostles, you know, they rushed to name a successor before God wanted them to, and they made a mistake. They elected Matthias, and God wanted Saul of Tarsus or Paul to be the successor of Judas. Now, allow me to say that this is pure myth. This is pure speculation. It is an assumption that is not based on fact. I'm going to give you now four reasons why the apostle that they chose was God's choice. And then towards the end of our study, I'm going to give you the most important reason, reason number five. But for now, we're going to go give four reasons why Matthias was the right choice. Notice reason number one. The Bible tells us what qualities the successor needed to have. I'm reading from Acts chapter 1 and verses 21 and 22, and you're going to tell me if Saul of Tarsus fits with the specifications. It says there, therefore of these men who have accompanied us all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John to that day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection. Let me ask you, does Saul of Tarsus meet that specification of being with the apostles from the times of John the Baptist till the ascension of Christ? He does not. He was converted 3.5 years after the ascension of Christ. And so he does not meet this specification. And so we know that Paul was definitely not God's choice. The second reason is that Acts 1, 24 to 26 tells us that they followed the right process. Notice what it says there beginning in verse 24. And they prayed and said, "You, O Lord, who know the hearts of all, show which of these two you have chosen to take part in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place." And they cast their lots, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. So notice it says that they prayed that the Lord would show them whom the Lord had chosen. They met the specification that God established to pray for guidance and wisdom to elect the right man. Now, Ellen White, this is reason number three, the confirmation from the spirit of prophecy, is that the Holy Spirit was the one who chose Matthias. Notice this statement that we find in Spirit of Prophecy, volume 3 and page 264. This is categorical. She says there, two men were selected who, in the careful judgment of the believers, were best qualified for the place. But the disciples, distrusting their ability to decide the question further, referred it to the one that knew all hearts. Were they careful in their judgment? Yes, they were. Did they distrust their own ability to decide? Yes, they did. Notice what she continues saying. They sought the Lord in prayer to ascertain which of the two men was more suitable for the important position of trust as an apostle of Christ. The Spirit of God selected Matthias for the office. So did they make a mistake? Was the Holy Spirit wrong in the selection? Absolutely not. The Holy Spirit made the choice according to this. Now the fourth reason is very clear, and that is that the person who was supposed to take the place of Stephen was Saul of Tarsus. In other words, Saul of Tarsus was not to take the place of Judas, he was supposed to take the place of Stephen, whom he was involved in martyrizing. Notice Acts of the Apostles, page 102, where that is made clear. Ellen White says, "A mightier than Satan had chosen Saul to take the place of the martyred Stephen, to preach and suffer for his name, and to spread far and wide the tidings of salvation through his blood." So who was Saul of Tarsus supposed to replace? Stephen. Not Judas, but Stephen. He was chosen to replace Stephen. But we still need to ask the question. You say, okay, Pastor Bohr, we accept the fact that first of all, prophecy predicted that Judas wasn't going to return to his house would remain desolate, and prophecy predicted that somebody had to take his office. But why did this have to happen before the day of Pentecost? Why couldn't they wait until the Holy Spirit was poured out, and then of course they would have more wisdom because they would have the Holy Spirit to elect the successor then? Why name the successor before the Holy Spirit was poured out on the day of Pentecost? The reason, folks, has to do with the significance of the number 12 in Scripture. Now when you examine Acts chapter 1, you find a very interesting expression. It says that Judas was numbered with the apostles. He was numbered with the apostles. And then when Matthias was elected, it says that he was numbered with the apostles. In other words, there's something significant about the number 12. There had to be 12. And so the question is, what is so significant about the number 12 that would require us to have 12 apostles and not merely 11? The answer to this question is found in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 1 and several other verses that we're going to take a look at now. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 1 says this, "Now a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars," or a crown of 12 stars. So we have a woman, and this woman has a crown on her head, and the crown has 12 stars. So the question is, what does the woman represent? Well, we know that in Bible prophecy, a woman represents what? Represents the church, represents God's faithful people. Now, let's prove that from the Bible itself. Go with me to Daniel chapter 7 and verse 25, and then we're going to compare with that Revelation 12 and verse 14. Daniel 7:25 first of all, and Revelation 12:14. These are two parallel prophecies. Notice Daniel chapter 7 and verse 25. It's speaking about the little horn. Of course, we know the little horn represents the Roman Catholic papacy. And so it says, "He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute," notice these details, "shall persecute the saints of the Most High." So whom does the little horn persecute? Persecutes the saints of the Most High. And then it continues saying, "and shall intend to change times and law. Then the saints shall be given into his hand for a time and times and half a time." So let's summarize what this verse contains. First of all, it says that the little horn, point number one, would persecute whom? The saints of the Most High for how long? Time, times, and the dividing of time. Now let's go to Revelation chapter 12 and verse 14. Remember, we're trying to interpret what the woman represents. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 14. This is a parallel prophecy, but it's expressed somewhat differently. It says here, "Now when the dragon saw that he had been cast to the earth, he persecuted the woman." So who is the persecutor here in Revelation 12? It's the dragon who is persecuting. And who is he persecuting? He's persecuting the woman. Now let's continue reading. "He persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child, but the woman was given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness to her place where she is nourished for a time and times and half a time from the presence of the serpent." Is that the same time period as Daniel 7:25? Yes, it is. Now let's make the parallel. In Daniel 7, the little horn persecutes the saints for time, times, and the dividing of time. In Revelation chapter 12, the dragon persecutes the woman for time, times, and the dividing of time. So let me ask you, what does the woman represent when you compare these two texts? The woman represents the saints of the Most High. It represents God's faithful people. Are you following me or not? So in Revelation chapter 12, this woman represents God's faithful people. But now we need to ask a very important question. You know, God has had a people, a faithful people, in the Old Testament as well as in the New Testament, hasn't He? He's had a church in the Old Testament and He's had a church in the New Testament. So the question here is this woman, is this faithful people that is spoken of here in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 1, the God's people from the Old Testament, God's faithful people from the Old Testament, or is it God's people from the New Testament, the faithful from the New Testament? Which stage are we talking about here? Well, the fact is, folks, there's no doubt that in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 1, the woman is representing God's people, God's faithful people in the Old Testament period. And you say, how do you know that the woman represents God's saints or God's faithful people from the Old Testament in Revelation 12 verse 1? The answer is very simple. In the next verse, it says that the woman has a male child in her womb, and the child has not been born yet. Who is that child that was in the womb of the woman? It's Jesus Christ, right? So if Jesus hadn't been born yet, this is so obvious, if Jesus had not been born yet when the woman is seen, is that talking about the New Testament church? How can you have a New Testament church if Jesus has not been born yet? Are you following me or not? Yes. Now, here's a dumb question. Who exists first, the woman or the child? The woman, of course. Did the Old Testament church exist before Jesus was born? Yes. This woman already existed before Jesus was born because she has Jesus in her womb and then He's born. But I want you to notice something very important. The woman represents, in Revelation 12 verse 1, it represents the Old Testament church from which Jesus comes, because Jesus is the descendant of Abraham and He's a descendant of David. He comes from the holy line of the Old Testament. So Jesus is born from the faithful Old Testament church. But then you notice in this prophecy that the woman then flees to the wilderness after the child is born. And she flees for 1,260 years. Let me ask you, what stage of the church is that after the child is born? That's the New Testament church. So in other words, you have, how many churches does Jesus have? You know, today there are many that are teaching, most interpreters of prophecy, not in the Adventist church, but outside the church, they say, you know, God has two peoples. He has literal Israel, and then he has the church, and two different plans. You know, he's going to rapture the church to heaven, and the Jews are going to be left behind. He has two mutually separable peoples. Revelation 12 makes it very clear that that's not the case. Revelation chapter 12 tells us that God has one woman from Old and New Testament period. From before the child is born and after the child is born, God has only one people throughout the course of all of history. And so this woman in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 1 represents the Old Testament church before the child is born. Now we need to understand what the 12 stars and the crown of the woman represents. So if this represents God's Old Testament people in Revelation 12 verse 1, and of course later on it represents the New Testament church, then what do the 12 stars on her crown represent? Well, we have to go back to Genesis 37 and verses 9 and 10. Genesis 37 and verses 9 and 10. This is one of the dreams that Joseph had. If you remember, Joseph was called the dreamer. He had many dreams that aggravated his brothers when he was still at home. And I want you to notice that we have sun, moon, and stars in one of his dreams. It says in Genesis 37 verse 9, "Then he," that is Joseph, "dreamed still another dream and told it to his brothers and said, 'Look, I have dreamed another dream.' And this time the sun, the moon," do we have sun, moon, and stars in Revelation 12? Yes, we do. So this is reminiscent of Revelation 12 and verse 1. It says, "And the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars bowed down to me." You say, "Ah, but that's not 12 stars, that's 11 stars." Yes, that is 11 stars, but who is star number 12? Star number 12 is Joseph. How many sons did Jacob have? Jacob had 12. So you have 11 stars bowing to Joseph, who is star number 12. And so notice it continues saying, "And this time the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars bowed down to me. So he told it to his father and his brothers, and his father rebuked him and said to him, 'What is this dream that you have dreamed? Shall your mother and I and your brothers indeed come to bow down to the earth before you?'" So the 12 stars represent the 12 sons of Jacob, which were the founders of the Old Testament church. Notice Genesis chapter 49 and verse 28. Let me ask you, did those 12 young men then multiply and become a great nation, 12 tribes? From 12 individuals, they multiplied and they became a great nation. That's very important. Notice Genesis 49 verse 28, after Jacob has given the characteristics of all of his sons, then we have this explanation. "All these are the 12 tribes of Israel, and this is what their father spoke to them, and he blessed them. He blessed them each according to his own blessing." And so you find here that the 12 founders of the Old Testament church were the 12 sons of Jacob. 12 individuals that then multiplied and formed a great nation. Now let me ask you, how many apostles did Jesus establish? Jesus established 12 apostles. Now why would he establish 12 apostles? Do you think that Jesus said, "Now let me see, what number can I choose here? 7 would be good, that's perfection. 4, that's universality, no, I don't like that. 3, the number of the God, no. I think I'll choose 12. Do you think that's what led Jesus to choose the number 12? Of course not. He was choosing the number 12 because the New Testament church is a continuation of the Old Testament church. Just like we saw in Revelation 12, there's one woman. One woman composed of two stages. And so the number 12 represents the 12 founders of the Old Testament church, but that church is continued by 12 founders of the New Testament church. Notice Mark chapter 3 and verses 14 through 19. Mark chapter 3 and verses 14 through 19. It says, "Then he appointed 12, that they might be with him, and that he might send them out to preach, and to have power to heal sicknesses and to cast out demons." And then comes the name, Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter, James, the son of Zebedee and John, the brother of James, to whom he gave the name Boanerges, that is sons of thunder, Andrew, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James the son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him. So Jesus appointed 12 apostles because the 12 apostles were going to be the founders of the New Testament church. Now Ellen White, whom I've always found to be very enlightening, a woman who had only 2.5 years of primary education, understood very well the importance of the number 12 and how the number 12 represents the founders of the Old Testament church and the founders of the New Testament church. One church composed of two stages. Notice what she says in the book Acts of the Apostles, page 19. She says, as in the Old Testament, the 12 patriarchs stood as representatives of Israel, so the 12 apostles stood as representatives of the gospel church. Is that clear? Absolutely crystal clear. Once again, as in the Old Testament the 12 patriarchs stood as representatives of Israel, so the 12 apostles stood as representatives of the gospel church. Now let me ask you, did those 12 then multiply through their preaching and become a great church or a great nation, so to speak? Absolutely. And so the New Testament church is a continuation of the Old Testament church. And I want to underline once again, you know, there's a theology today of prophecy which is called dispensationalism that radically distinguishes literal Israel from the church. The fact is Revelation 12 makes it impossible to separate literal Israel from the church because there's only one woman that represents both stages of the church. The same woman that has the child is the woman that then flees to the wilderness for 1,260 years. One church composed of two stages. The founders of the Old Testament church, 12 representatives, sons of Jacob. The founders of the New Testament church, 12 apostles. 12 individuals then multiply and become a great nation. 12 individuals then multiply and become a global or worldwide church. Now we must ask the question, come back to our question again. Why did they feel such an urgency of naming a successor in place of Judas before the day of Pentecost? You say, okay, prophecy said that they had to elect a successor. We accept that. But why did the election have to take place before the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at the day of Pentecost? The answer to that question has to do with what happened to Jesus during the 10 days between the ascension and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Do you remember that Jesus ascended 40 days after his resurrection and then 10 days passed before the Holy Spirit was poured out? During those 10 days we know what the apostles were doing. They were praying, they were studying prophecy, they were ironing out their differences, they were placing their possessions at the service of the work, they were being emptied of self. We know what they were doing, but what was happening to Jesus during those 10 days? There are a couple of prophecies which are very significant. The first of these is found in Leviticus 8 and verses 6 through 12. Leviticus chapter 8 and verses 6 through 12 tells us that a very impressive ceremony took place in heaven during those 10 days. Notice what it says beginning at verse 6. Then Moses brought Aaron and his sons and washed them with water. This is right before the temple service or the sanctuary service is inaugurated in the Old Testament. Verse 7, and he put the tunic on him, girded him with the sash, clothed him with the robe, and put the ephod on him, and he girded him with the intricately woven band of the ephod, and with it tied the ephod on him. Then he put the breastplate on him, and he put the Urim and the Thummim in the breastplate, and he put the turban on his head. Also on the turban, on its front, he put the golden plate, the holy crown, as the Lord had commanded Moses. What is Moses doing here to Aaron, his brother? He is clothing him to be what? High priest. You see, before he could begin serving as high priest, he had to be clothed as a high priest. And Moses is playing the role of God the Father in the ultimate fulfillment. Moses is a symbol of the Father, and Christ is symbolized by Aaron, the high priest. And so it was necessary for Moses to clothe Aaron as the high priest before he could begin serving as the high priest in the sanctuary. But that's the first thing that happened. There's more. Notice what it continues saying in verse 10. Also Moses took the anointing oil and anointed the tabernacle and all that was in it, and consecrated them. He sprinkled some of it on the altar seven times, anointed the altar and all its utensils and the laver and its base to consecrate them. So what is he doing? He's sanctifying the place where the high priest is going to serve. So he's anointing the place or the sanctuary where the high priest is going to serve. So two things are happening here in the Old Testament type. Number one, Moses is clothing Aaron with the garments of the high priest. Then he says, well, he's going to serve in the holy sanctuary. So he sanctifies the sanctuary where Aaron is going to serve. But then there's one ceremony that still needs to be performed, and that's found in verse 12. And he poured some of the anointing oil on Aaron's head and anointed him to consecrate him. And so the third thing that is happening here is that Moses is anointing Aaron with oil. So three things. Number one, Moses clothes Aaron as high priest. Number two, he anoints the sanctuary where the high priest is going to serve. And number three, he anoints the high priest with oil. And what does oil represent? You know very well that oil represents the Holy Spirit. Now Psalm 133 describes this same occasion when Aaron was anointed with the oil. And immediately when you read Psalm 133, you're going to see the connection with the day of Pentecost. It's very, very clear the way it begins. Notice Psalm 133, and this is a very short psalm. It has only three verses, so we'll be able to go through it quite quickly. It says there, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." What does that bring to mind? When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all of one accord. So this is what you might call a Pentecostal psalm. It's a psalm about Pentecost. And so it says, "Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious oil." Now here comes the amplification of the anointing of Aaron by Moses. "It is like the precious oil upon" where first? "The head." Are we talking about just one or two, three, four, five dots? No. Notice. It says here, "It is like the precious oil upon the head running down on the beard." So we're talking about not a few drops. We're talking about an abundance of oil because it's running down his beard. The beard of whom? Ah, this is the same anointing service. The beard of Aaron. Oh, this, notice how abundant it is. It says, running down on the edge of his garments. Boy, this is a lot of oil. You know, it's poured on his head. This isn't only sprinkle. It's poured on his head. It runs down his beard. It's so abundant that it's running to the edges of his garments, but it doesn't stop there. Notice verse 3. "It is like the dew of Hermon descending upon" what? "The mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, life forevermore." The oil was so abundant that it trickled down even on the mountains of Zion. Let me ask you, who was gathered on the mountains of Zion? The 12 apostles. You see, the gift of the Holy Spirit, before it was given to the apostles, it was given to Christ. It was the promise of the Father to Christ. And so the Father gave the promise of the Holy Spirit to Jesus, and then what did Jesus do? Jesus poured out the promise of the Holy Spirit upon his followers. And what happened on the day of Pentecost, the tongues of fire and the mighty rushing wind and the fact that they were speaking in tongues was an earthly announcement that Jesus had been anointed as the high priest in the heavenly sanctuary. Now notice Hebrews chapter 8 verses 1 and 2. Hebrews 8 verses 1 and 2. Here the Apostle Paul clearly says that when Jesus went to heaven, he was installed as our high priest. This is what he says. "Now this is the main point of the things we are saying. We have such a high priest who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle which the Lord erected and not man." What do we have in the heavenly sanctuary? We have a high priest. Would he have had to have been clothed in order to serve as the high priest? Absolutely. Would it have been necessary to anoint the sanctuary where he was going to serve? Yeah. Absolutely. Would it have been necessary for Jesus to have been anointed or received the gift of the Holy Spirit to then pour it out upon his apostles? Absolutely. Jesus fulfills the Old Testament type. Now you say, Pastor Moore, you still haven't answered the question. Why was it necessary to elect a successor for Judas before the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost? Well, we weren't ready to understand it before, but now we're ready to understand the reason why. It had to happen before the day of Pentecost. There was a specific reason in Bible prophecy why apostle number 12 had to be elected before Jesus was clothed as a high priest. Go with me to another prophecy that we find in the book of Exodus, chapter 28, and we'll read verse 21, and then we'll read verses 29 and 30. Exodus 28, verse 21, and then we'll jump down to verses 29 and 30. Actually, I want to encourage you to read verse 21 all the way down to verse 30, but because of the time, we can't read the whole passage. It says in verse 21, this talking about the breastplate of the high priest. Remember, he had a breastplate that was a perfect square on his chest over his heart. It says, "And the stones shall have the names of the sons of Israel, 12 according to their names, like the engravings of a signet, each one with its own name, and they shall be according to the 12 tribes." So the 12 names were really symbolic of what? Of the 12 tribes, of all the people. In these 12 representatives was included all of Israel. In other words, now let's go down to verse 29. "So Aaron shall bear the names of the sons of Israel on the breastplate of judgment over his heart when he goes into the holy place, as a memorial before the Lord continually. And you shall put in the breastplate of judgment the Urim and the Thummim, and they shall be over Aaron's heart when he goes in before the Lord. So Aaron shall bear the judgment of the children of Israel over his heart before the Lord continually." Amen. Let me ask you, who deserves to fall under the judgment of God? We do. We deserve to fall under the judgment of God. We deserve to be punished for sin because we are the transgressors. But the fact that Jesus wears the breastplate of judgment over his heart, notice it says here that he bears the judgment of the children of Israel over his heart. He bears our judgment, which means that when I sin and I come to Jesus as the high priest and I say to Jesus, "Lord, I've sinned. I deserve to die because the wages of sin is death. But I believe that you lived the perfect life, and I believe that you died in my place. Lord Jesus, would you please accept me? I'm repentant. I'm confessing my sin. I trust in your merits. Would you please take your life and your death and place them to my account?" Jesus will place them to my account, and he will look at me as if I had never sinned because he bears my judgment upon his heart.
Amen.
Notice Isaiah 53 verses 4 and 5. That same expression "bear" is used there with regards to the Messiah. Notice Isaiah 53 verses 4 and 5. It's speaking about the Messiah. It says, "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows." What has he done? He's borne what? He's borne. That's the same word, the same Hebrew word. He's borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. "Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted." Did he bear our judgment upon himself? Notice verse 5, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." He bears the judgment of his people upon his heart. Isn't that great news?
Amen.
That's wonderful news. It's music to my ears. Now you say, what about the number 12? We still haven't answered why they had to elect the successor before the day of Pentecost. Let me explain why. We've already noticed that when Jesus went to heaven, the Father clothed him as the high priest. Is that point clear? The Father clothed him as a high priest. So must Jesus have a breastplate over his heart? Does Jesus have a breastplate over his heart? How many stones does the breastplate have?
12.
With regards to the New Testament, what do those 12 stones represent? They represent the 12 apostles. And who do the 12 apostles represent? All of God's people. Just like the 12 founders, all of God's people are represented in the 12. In the 12 apostles, all of God's people are represented in the names of the 12 apostles on the breastplate of Christ, on the 12 stones. But now here's the problem. How could Jesus put on the breastplate with 12 stones representing the 12 apostles if on earth there were only 11 apostles? Are you following me or not? There were only 11. So how could Jesus wear the breastplate of judgment with 12 stones representing the 12 apostles if on earth there were only 11? It was necessary to elect apostle number 12 so that Jesus could use the breastplate with the 12 stones over his heart. There is a reason for everything in Scripture. You see, they didn't jump the gun and say, oh, let's just elect a successor, and they did it, you know, rushing, and they made a mistake. No. They did it exactly when they had to do it, because they knew that Jesus was going to be clothed as the high priest. He was going to wear the breastplate with 12 stones. So they said, if there's going to be 12 stones on his breastplate, there have to be 12 apostles on the earth. Now, do you know what Christ's yearning desire is, folks? The yearning desire of Jesus is to have his people with him. That's why he has the breastplate over his heart, because he wants his people with him. You know, that's the passion of Christ. We already read in John 14, 1-3, when Jesus was in the upper room, he says to his disciples, you know, that where I am, there you may be also.
Amen.
I want you with me, Jesus said, in the upper room. That's before he went to the Garden of Gethsemane. And then in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus is praying to his Father. I want you to notice John 17, 24 and 25, the climax of his prayer in the garden for his disciples and for everyone who believe in his name. He says, Father, I desire that they also whom you gave me may be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which you have given me, for you loved me before the foundation of the world. Father, I want my own to be with me where I am. That was his prayer. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he had already stated to his disciples in the upper room. And do you know, when Jesus arrived in heaven, we've studied this before, the war hero, the victorious war hero. Remember, we studied lecture number one, the return of the war hero, when he finally appeared before his Father in the heavenly sanctuary. And he told the angels, don't sing until I've talked to my Father. I want to read the description in Desire of Ages 8:34. What was the passion of Christ? Notice, when upon the cross he cried out, it is finished, he addressed the Father. The compact had been fully carried out. Now he declares, this is at his ascension, Father, it is finished. I have done thy will, O my God. I have completed the work of redemption. If thy justice is satisfied, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am. So when he was in the upper room, he said it. In his prayer in the garden, he said it. When he ascended to heaven, he said it. Jesus wants us to be with him. He bears us over his heart. In the book Gospel Workers, page 34, Ellen White gives this beautiful description of the meaning of the breastplate. She says, of Aaron, the high priest of Israel, it is written, he shall bear the names of the children of Israel in the breastplate of judgment upon his heart, when he goeth in unto the holy place for a memorial before the Lord continually. And then she explains what a beautiful and expressive figure this is of the unchanging love of Christ for his church. Our great high priest, of whom Aaron was a type, bears his people upon his heart. And should not his earthly ministers share his love and sympathy and solicitude? What a beautiful description of the meaning of the breastplate. Now, do you know that someday soon, very soon, I believe, by what we see happening in the world, Jesus is going to return to take all of his people to the New Jerusalem. And do you know that in the New Jerusalem will be represented the 12? All of his people will be together in the same city. I want you to notice as we close how the number 12 is encased in the New Jerusalem. There's no such thing as God having an earthly city for the literal Jews and a heavenly city for the church. That just doesn't pan out. Scripture doesn't uphold that view. There's going to be one city with the redeemed from all ages in that city with the Lord. Notice Revelation chapter 21 and verse 12. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 12. It's speaking here about the gates of the holy city. And it says, "And she," that is the city, "had a great and high wall with 12 gates, and 12 angels at the gates, and names written on them, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel." Are God's Old Testament people represented in the city? Absolutely. What about the New Testament church? Notice Revelation chapter 21 and verse 14. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 14. It says, "Now the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb." One city with all of God's people from the Old and from the New Testament. Isn't that marvelous? The day that all of God's people will meet together. I end by reading Acts of the Apostles, page 601. What is it that upheld Jesus while he hung on the cross? Why was Jesus willing to go through with it, even at the risk of being eternally separated from his Father? Here's the answer. What sustained the Son of God during his life of toil and sacrifice? He saw the results of the travail of his soul and was satisfied. Looking into eternity, he beheld the happiness of those who through his humiliation had received pardon and everlasting life. His ear caught the shout of the redeemed. He heard the ransomed ones singing the song of Moses and the Lamb. Amen. In other words, as Jesus hung on the cross, he could hear the voices of the triumphant people, his followers in the future, who would have been redeemed by his blood. I pray to God that when that great day arrives, that all of us will be present there, that none of us will be missing in that great day, when all of God's people from all ages will meet together in the New Jerusalem. Amen. All right. Any questions?